Hello, and welcome to Controllers Tech. In the previous video, we explored how to interface the 1.28-inch GC9801 round LCD display with the STM32 microcontroller. We also integrated LVGL into our project and designed a basic user interface using Squareline Studio. Today, we will continue with the same topic, but this time I will demonstrate how to display an analog clock on the GC9801 display. To achieve this, I will first design the clock in Squareline Studio and then use the STM32 RDC module to keep the clock updated with the correct time. For this project, we will need images for the clock face and its hands. I have already downloaded the required images, which include the watch face, the hour hand, the minute hand, and the second hand. These images must be in PNG format, as this format supports transparency, which is crucial for creating a realistic clock. Separate images for each element are necessary because we need to rotate the individual hands to simulate the clock's movement. The hardware connection between the display and STM32 will remain exactly the same as in the previous tutorial. I will also continue with the same project file from the previous video, but I have renamed it to GC9801 Part 2 for better organization. Now, let's open Squareline Studio to start designing the analog clock. Begin by creating a new project and select the latest version of LVGL, which is 9.2. Choose the Eclipse with SDL option for PC, and then create a dedicated folder for this project. The GC9801 display has a resolution of 240 by 240 pixels, and it is a circular display. The color depth is 16 bits, and for this project, we will work with the latest LVGL version, which is 9.2.2. All right, we now have our circular screen ready in the workspace. Let's start by adding the first image to the screen. As I mentioned earlier, I already have the required images, so the next step is to import these images into the Assets panel. You need to add them one by one. The first image we will add is the watch face. After that, add the second image, which will be the second hand of the clock. Let's position this second hand correctly on top of the watch face. To create the motion of the second hand, we will need to rotate this image. Let's experiment with different rotation values to see how it behaves. You will notice that the entire image rotates when we change the rotation parameter. However, to achieve proper clock movement, we need to define a pivot point for this image so that it rotates around a fixed position, just like a real clock hand. I will set this pivot point for the second hand now. The pivot point for the image can be set by entering the corresponding X and Y coordinates. These coordinates are defined relative to the image itself, meaning the origin point, 0, 0, is located at the top left corner of the image. To determine the correct pivot coordinates, you can use an image editing tool, such as GIMP. Let's open this image in GIMP to find the exact values. Here, you can see the starting point of the image is located at 0, 0. I need the coordinates of a specific point on the second hand where the rotation should occur. You can see the coordinate values displayed at the bottom left corner of the screen as you hover over the image. For this particular second hand image, the pivot point turns out to be at 2.27. Let's enter these coordinates for the pivot and then rotate the image again. Now you can see that the image rotates perfectly around the pivot point, just like a real second hand on an analog clock. Let's experiment with a few different rotation values. From this test, you can see that 5 seconds of movement are represented by 300 rotation units. This means that each second corresponds to 60 rotation units. Make sure to keep this calculation in mind, as we will need it later while writing the code to update the clock. Next, let's add another image. This time, I will use the hour hand of the clock. Align the hour hand carefully so that its center overlaps exactly with the pivot point of the second hand. Just like before, we also need to find a pivot point for this hour hand image. So, let's open this image in GIMP and identify the correct coordinates. The pivot point for the hour hand will be set at this particular position, which is located at the center of the circle with coordinates 46, 33. Let's set these coordinates as the pivot point and test the rotation of the hour hand. The hour hand is rotating smoothly, just as expected. Now, let's move on and add one more image for the minute hand. We will align this image in a similar manner, ensuring that the center of the circle is aligned with the pivot points of the other clock hands. Next, we need to determine the pivot coordinates for the minute hand. The correct pivot point for this hand is 7:43. Let's enter these coordinates and test the rotation for the minute hand. Perfect! All three hands, the hour, minute, and second hands, are now rotating properly. The next step is to align all the clock hands to midnight hours, which is the 12 o'clock position. The second hand needs to be rotated by 1800 units, which will serve as its offset. Remember this value as we will use it later. For the hour hand, we need to rotate it by 600 units. This will be the offset for the hour hand. Now, finally, we will adjust the minute hand. Let me fine-tune the alignment of all three hands so that they are perfectly centered. All right, they look good now. After some minor adjustments, the hour hand now has an offset of 620 units. Next, let's calculate the offset for the minute hand. Since we need to move it in the counterclockwise direction, we will use negative rotation values. A rotation of minus 550 units aligns the minute hand exactly to the 12 o'clock position. So, our final offsets are plus 1800 for the second hand, plus 620 for the hour hand, minus 550 for the minute hand. This completes all the design work required for now. Let's move to the project settings. Here, we need to specify the path where the generated UI files will be stored. I am creating a new folder named UI inside the project folder to keep everything organized. The LVGL path remains the same as we discussed in the previous video. Now save the project and export the UI files so they can be used inside our firmware. Let's open our STM32Cube project that we created in the previous tutorial and delete the existing UI folder from the LVGL directory. Copy the new UI folder that we just generated into the same location inside the project, replacing the old one. If you open the UI_screen.c file, you will see the updated code for all the images we designed in Squareline Studio. This confirms that the export worked correctly. Let's build this project to check for any errors. There are no errors here, so let's flash the project to the board. You can see that the UI has been loaded on the display. All three hands are aligned at 12, just as we designed them. Now we will use the RDC peripheral of the STM32 to fetch the current time. Let's open CubeMX to configure the RDC. Go to the timer section, select RDC, and activate the clock source. Also make sure to activate the calendar feature. If your development board has a 32.768 kHz external low-speed crystal, you can enable it in the RCC configuration. I am leaving the RTC clock source as the low-speed internal oscillator at 32 kHz. Let's configure the RDC parameters now. I am keeping the 24-hour time format. The asynchronous and synchronous pre-divider values together act as the prescaler for the RDC clock. We must choose these values so that the RDC clock is reduced to exactly 1 Hz. You can find more details about these dividers in the reference manual of your microcontroller. Look inside the RTC section of the reference manual. The formula to calculate the final clock is shown there. Let's do the calculations. If we use the default values in the formula, the RDC clock will be approximately 0.98 Hz. These default values are actually configured for an external crystal of 32.768 kHz, which results in an accurate 1 Hz clock. But as I mentioned earlier, I'm using a 32 kHz source clock here. Therefore, I will modify the synchronous pre-divider value to 250. This adjustment results in the RDC clock being exactly 1 Hz, which is what we need. Let's input these values into CubeMX. The asynchronous pre-divider value is already set to 127, so we will set the synchronous pre-divider value to 249. Now, configure the data format as binary and enter some random time. We will set the correct time later through the code itself. That's it for the RDC configuration. Leave the rest of the settings as default and click Save to generate the project code. We now have the mx_rtc_init function, which is responsible for initializing the RDC. The first half of this function initializes the RDC peripheral, while the later half configures the time and date. Let's copy the part that sets the time and comment it out here. This is done to prevent the RDC initialization function from resetting the time every time the board is rebooted. Instead, we will create a new function to configure the time, and this function will accept time values as parameters. Inside this function, we will define an RDC time structure and initialize it with zeros. We will then pass the time data from the parameters into the respective elements of this structure. Since we are only working with the time and not the date, there is no need to set the date here. We will call this setTime function inside the main function. So whenever the board is reset, the same input time will be configured for the RDC. To avoid resetting the time repeatedly, we can use the RDC backup register. For this, we will wrap the entire time setting process inside an if condition, which first checks the value of backup register 0. The predefined time will only be configured if the value stored in backup register 0 is not 0x4321. This value is not special or fixed. It's just a random value I chose for this check. Obviously, when the code runs for the very first time, backup register 0 will not contain this value. Therefore, the input time will be configured to the RDC. After setting the time, we will call the write function to store this value, 0x4321, into backup register 0. Now imagine the board is reset after the first run. In that case, the function will again check for the value 0x4321, which is now present in backup register 0. Since the value matches, the function will not reset the time again and will simply exit. Next, let's define another function to update the clock display. In this function, we will first define RDC time and date structures. Then, we will call the function hal_rdc_getTime to read the current time. The time will be stored in the structure gtime, and we will use the binary data format for simplicity. We also need to call hal_rdc_getDate, even though we are not using the date directly, because reading the date is required to unlock the RDC shadow registers. Now, we will start by updating the second hand on the clock using the current time data. Let's open Squareline Studio to recall the movement of the second hand. The second hand sweeps 60 rotation units for every second, and remember that it has an initial offset of plus 1800. Let's define a signed integer variable to store the rotation value. We need to calculate this rotation value based on how many seconds have passed since zero. For this, multiply the second value by 60, because each second corresponds to 60 rotation units. After this calculation, add the offset to align the second's hand to its correct position. Now that we have the final rotation value, we will call the function lv_mg_set_angle to set this rotation for image 2, which represents the second's hand. Next, we will calculate the rotation value for the minute's hand. To do this, fetch the current minute value from the time structure and multiply it by 60. The minute's hand also sweeps 60 rotation units for every minute, which is why we multiply it by 60. The offset for the minute's hand is minus 550, so we will use this value directly in the code. If we leave the calculation as it is right now, the minute's hand will work, but it will jump abruptly from 1 minute to the next, sweeping 60 rotation units instantly. I will demonstrate this behavior shortly. To make the movement smoother and visually appealing, we will add the seconds data into the calculation, so the minute's hand can move gradually rather than jumping suddenly. Let's see how this works. For example, if the rotation value is currently 0, the minute's hand points to 9 minutes. If it instantly sweeps 60 rotations, it will directly jump to 10 minutes. But when we also include the seconds data in the calculation, the minute's hand moves slowly and transitions from 9 to 10 minutes in a continuous motion. We now have the correct rotation value for the minute's hand. So let's apply it to the corresponding image. Next, we will perform the same calculation for the hour's hand. The hour's hand sweeps 300 rotation units for every hour. So we need to multiply the current hour value by 300. Also note that the minute's hand corresponds to image 5, not image 4. The offset for the hour's hand is plus 620. To make the hour's hand movement gradual, we will also add the minute's data into this calculation, but this time we will multiply the minutes by 5. This is because each minute sweeps 60 rotation units, and a full 60 minutes should sweep 300 rotations for the hour hand, which equals 60 times 5. Finally, we will apply this calculated rotation value to image 4, which represents the hour's hand. Now, inside the main function, after initializing the UI, call the function to set the time to the RDC. I am setting it 1 minute ahead of the current time for demonstration purposes. Inside the while loop, we will call the update clock function to continuously refresh the clock UI based on the current time data. Even though this function is called every 5 milliseconds, the RDC time itself updates every second, and therefore the clock hands rotate smoothly according to real time. Let's build the project now. There are no errors in the build, so let's flash the project to the board. You can now see that the clock is displaying the current time, which is 12 hours and 12 minutes. The seconds hand is ticking every second, and it is sweeping the correct angle for each tick. Now, I will reset the board to check if the time gets reset to our predefined values. As you can see, the time does not reset to the defined values. Instead, it continues to tick from the current time. This behavior is due to the backup register we configured earlier before setting up the time. So, everything is working exactly as expected. We are successfully displaying a stylish analog clock on the GC9801 display. The movement of all the clock hands is smooth and accurate. You can try experimenting with different clock face designs and even extend this project by adding features such as date and day display on the analog clock. That's all for this video. I hope all the steps were explained clearly. You can download the complete project from the link provided in the description. If you have any doubts or questions, feel free to leave a comment. Keep watching and have a great day ahead.